Welcome everybody. It's so good to have you gather with us. Graham Dunn will be speaking later and leading us in communion. So you might want to pause this and find bread and wine or juice so that we can share communion together later on.
Let's begin our time of worship together by singing this song.
Let us pray together. Father, we come before you, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, Maker of heaven and earth. We praise you for who you are, extravagantly kind, full of grace and mercy, blessing us abundantly even though we do not deserve it. We thank you that you are our God and Saviour, that you have given us such a beautiful world to live in, music and art to appreciate, friends and family to spend our lives with. Even at this time, Lord, we thank you that we can communicate through telephones and other technology. And we pray for those who are living alone, that they may know your presence with them during this time and on into the future. We pray for family and friends we know who are sick, but also those who are suffering with COVID-19 and their families, especially the relatives who are grieving the loss of loved ones. Be their comfort and companion at this time. We ask that you would give wisdom to all the leaders that you have put over us, the leadership team of this church, as they hear from you and make decisions concerning the future that you want for us, for civic and national leaders, that they would make wise decisions for our nation and show compassion for the most vulnerable in this country and throughout the world. We ask for boldness to be followers of Jesus that are different to the people around us, seeking, seeing, and loving the lost like you do. Give us your heart of compassion and a desire to see your kingdom come in Rutland, in this nation, and throughout this world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Graham is going to speak to us in a moment from Luke chapter 5, verses 1 to 11. But just before he does, I'm going to read the passage. One day, as he was preaching on the shore of Lake Gennesaret, great crowds pressed in on him to listen to the word of God. He noticed two empty boats standing at the water's edge, while the fishermen washed their nets. Stepping into one of the boats, Jesus asked Simon, its owner, to push out a little into the water so that he could sit in the boat and speak to the crowds from there. When he'd finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Now go out where it's deeper and let down your nets and you will catch a lot of fish." "Sir," Simon replied, "we worked hard all last night and didn't catch a thing. But if you say so, we'll try again." And this time their nets were so full that they began to tear. A shout for help brought to their partners in the other boat, and soon both boats were filled with fish and on the verge of sinking. When Simon Peter realized what had happened, he fell to his knees before Jesus and said, "Oh, sir, please leave us. I'm too much of a sinner for you to have around you." For he was awestruck by the size of their catch, as were the others with him, and his partners too, James and John, the sons of Zebedee. Jesus replied, "Don't be afraid. From now on you'll be fishing for the souls of men." And as soon as they landed, they left everything and went with him.
Well, hello, Oakham Baptist Church. What a privilege it is to be invited into your homes. I do promise that I'll behave. I'll try not to spill any coffee on your sofa. But thank you for allowing me to be with you. If you have a Bible handy, please open it at Luke 5, 1 to 11, the passage that has just been read out to us. Now, I love this passage. There are the two main characters, obviously, of Peter and Jesus. But also many others there. There's the fishermen and their families, fish sellers, and people generally going about their business. And it is as if Luke is inviting us to come in and witness what is going on. So let's picture it now. Mid-morning on the shore of Lake Galilee, a warm, sunny day. There is the gentle sound of waves gently lapping onto the shore. The smell of fresh fish is in the air. Opportunistic birds fill the air with their screeching as they swoop down trying to steal an easy meal. Fishermen are cleaning and sorting their nets, sharing stories of the catches of the previous evening. And other people buy and sell fish. And Jesus enters the scene. As usual, a crowd follows him. He's still in the early days of his ministry, but his reputation has grown as a teacher, healer, and performer of miracles. And as Jesus passes by Peter, who is glumly sorting out his fishing gear after a wasted night of fishing, Jesus stops. Now, Luke has already recorded that Jesus had visited Peter's house and had healed his mother-in-law. I think Jesus has already spotted the potential that is in Peter, even if there was a lot of remoulding to do. I think he liked the raw material. And of course, as we journey through the Gospels, we too discover Peter's character. He is a natural leader, he's intelligent, he's brave, he's a good man. But we also discover he is impulsive, restless with a short attention span, too self-reliant. But then again, to be fair to Peter, he did have a lot of qualities to be reliant upon. And there he sat, the chief executive of his own little fishing business with a cash flow problem. No fish to sell. He will have to pay his workers from his reserves. And so he sits glumly cleaning his nets, giving half an ear to Jesus and everything else going on. But Jesus wants Peter's full attention. And so he pulls off a masterstroke. Come with me, Peter. Let me borrow your boat. See, Jesus wants to use it as a preaching platform a short distance from the shore. But a secondary benefit is that Peter will have to sit without distractions and listen. The recruitment of Peter begins. And we have Peter's first response. Okay, I'll take you out. Now, Luke does not tell us the details of what Jesus said and taught that day. But from the response of Peter, we can deduct that it was very powerful and indeed life-changing. When Jesus had finished talking, he tells Peter to put out into deeper water and let down the nets. Now, Luke gives us some detail which allows us to come from the shore actually into the boat and see exactly what is happening. And I'm hoping that as we do that, we can appreciate the dilemma that Peter is in. Remember, many people are watching and Peter is a respected fisherman. So let me give you the basic rule of fishing on Lake Galilee. It's really simple. Fish at night near the shore. The reason is that at night the fish come out of the deep waters to the oxygen-rich water where the streams from the mountains come bubbling into the lake, and the fish feed on the water plants and the insects, but it's night and so they have the protection from the birds that would otherwise try to come down and take them. Now, of course, for the fishermen, the problem is there's lots of weeds that can get tangled in the nets, which is why Peter was on the shore cleaning them. But to put it another way, to fish in the daytime is futile, dare I say, foolish. And Peter is in a dilemma. What does this carpenter from the hill country of Nazareth know about fishing? Well, clearly not a lot. And there is a crowd on the shore watching who will think that Peter is a fool if they see him fishing in deep water in the middle of the day. There's a bit of a reputation thing going on here. And so Peter puts up a little bit of a protest. We've fished all night and caught nothing. But then we have his second response. Because you say so, I will do it. Now, I might not be the only one, but I think I can hear an edge in Peter's voice that he's saying, okay, Jesus, but it's your idea, not mine. On your head be it. Yes, there is a degree of obedience from Peter, but it is wrapped up in a lot of doubt. But then we have the result. A miraculous catch of fish. So many, in fact, that the nets begin to break. And Peter has to beckon to his partners, the other hired men and partners, to come and help. Now, he doesn't call out to everyone. This is a private windfall. The two boats are filled and they're filled so much that they are low in the water and water begins to lap over the edges by the weight of the fish. Now, one of the things that is easy to forget is that this is a windfall of significant financial value, maybe up to the equivalent of 3 months of fish caught in one day. A huge bonus that he could only ever dream of. Immediately, his cash flow problems are lifted. He may even have enough to purchase another boat. But then we get a further response from Peter, his third. He falls at Jesus' feet and says, "Go away from me, for I am a sinful man." Now, it's much later that Peter comes to the knowledge of Jesus as the Messiah. But he has seen enough to know that this preacher man of God is so much more than a carpenter from Nazareth. The response is an act of repentance. Peter becomes aware of the sin of doubt that he was expressing a short while earlier, but also the sin of his lifestyle. In effect, Peter is saying to Jesus, "I ought not to be in your presence. You are a holy man. Please leave a sinful man like me. Don't be tainted by my sin," is the plea of Peter. Now, of course, we know we can never taint Jesus by our sin. And Jesus responds, "Don't be afraid." The phrase that is so often heard from the mouth of Jesus, "Don't be afraid." And then he speaks words of prophecy over Peter. "From now on, you will fish for people." And we know from all that follows that Christ takes Peter on a physical and spiritual journey of transformation, releasing the potential that Christ knew was inside and moulding him into the man that God created him to be. And the final response of Peter is to pull the boat onto the beach, leave everything and follow Jesus. The huge catch of fish, the windfall, is left in the care of his employees and other family members. They can take care of the business from now on. But Peter had seen enough to know where he must go. He must follow Jesus. Was that going to be for a day, a week, a month, a year, a lifetime, eternity? At this point, Peter did not know. But for now, for today, he was following Jesus. Possibly with a question. What exactly does he mean about being a fisher of men? So how might all of this speak into our lives, into our church, into our situation in the middle of the COVID-19 crisis in 2020? Well, there is so much that we can take away from this. Sadly, we can't comprehensively cover it all this morning. And my hope is that you will return to it at some point in the future and just ask God as you read it, "God, what are you saying to me from this passage?" But for now, for me, I have felt God prompt me to focus in and ask, how do we become fishers of people as a church and as individuals? But before I answer that, or before we allow the passage to answer that, let's ask the question, should we become fishers of people? Well, I'll answer that straight away by going to Matthew's Gospel, to Matthew 28, 19, 20, and it is the Great Commission. And Jesus said to the disciples, "Go and teach everyone everything I've commanded you and baptize them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit." I'm not your minister. But I have heard people at OBC say, we are to be a missional church. That is telling people about the good news of Jesus Christ and then inviting them to follow Jesus. This is what we believe we've been commissioned to do in the fishing grounds, or if you prefer, the harvest fields of Oakham and Rutland that have been entrusted to us. So if we are to be fishers of people, how do we do it? Well, I want to look at two things. We are to use our resources. And second, we are to work together. We are to use the resources God has blessed us with. The people, the skills, the contacts, the building, the finances and many other things. Let's briefly look at those in turn. Looking at people first. OBC has lots of people with different skills. Musicians, preachers, Lego model makers, IT and media skill people, people with organisation skills, pastoral skills, hospitality skills, children and youth work skills. The list goes on and on because you are a very gifted church. You're also blessed with contacts. You're blessed with community contacts. You have Sanctuary, Tiddlers, Lego Club. In normal times, many people come through the doors every week. Well, tell them your story. Tell them why you are a follower of Jesus. Tell them the big, amazing story about God, about creation and his rescue plan through Jesus. Tell them about the big invitation that he issues to everyone to be part of his eternal ongoing story. And tell these people how you are weaving your story into God's story. And show them by how you live that it is transforming you and your life. And never be afraid of your imperfections, your mistakes and weaknesses. Everyone has them. Show vulnerability by owning up to them. But demonstrate how God works through these and slowly transforms you and your life. And so I ask you never to be embarrassed about the good news of God's story and how it is playing out in your life in 2020. And how it could be, very importantly, playing out in their lives. Be real about your faith, your struggles and your life. You have God's powerful story to share. But it is made much more relevant and powerful and real if you weave your story into it. And you don't always have to land the catch. Trust God and his Holy Spirit and other Christians to do their bit too. But always be prepared to tell people why you have hope. Another resource you are blessed with is a building. Questions are being asked about how to improve and upgrade it. It is an exciting time. Now, of course, the building is not to be a monument, but rather a resource centre from which you can go out, but also invite people back to. You're also blessed with finances as a church and as individuals. Some of you will recognise the joy of a windfall that Peter had. For some of you, that may come in the form of a pension, or maybe a bonus or a redundancy payout, or maybe a sale of an asset. Treat that as God's provision for you to serve him. Always giving your tithe, but then asking God how you may serve him with all your resources. Now, the point I'm making here is that OBC, you are not without resources. Use them to serve God's kingdom purposes. And then put it all together and work as a team, which is the second thing I wanted to highlight. And Neil spoke about this last week in the little video clip he did. And one thing I hope you can all see from the passage of this morning is that when Jesus spoke of fishing, he was talking about net fishing, not rod and line. Net fishing is a team effort. Rod and line is a solo effort. We need each other. And in some way, we are all to be a part of the net. We weave the threads of our lives into the threads of other people's lives. And then we weave it into God's threads and create a bigger fishing net that becomes the fishing net that will help us to fish for people. And we cannot do this alone. Everybody is part of the net. Or if you prefer to use a different analogy in keeping with 1 Corinthians 12, we are the body of Christ. Each of us has a function, and if we do not play out our part, the whole body suffers. So there you have it. The blueprint for effective church growth. Add in a bit of organisation here and there. Add in some leadership. Add in some cracking good services. And away you go. No, no, no. That isn't the blueprint, because it is missing one vital ingredient, God. If we don't have God, we can do all the right things in the right way, the equivalent of fishing all night in the shallow waters, and be totally ineffective. Like Peter, we need to listen to God and have him at the center of all that we are doing. We need the teaching and example of Christ. Literally, we need to sit at his feet and through the Bible, listen and learn from him. We need to be in communication with God through prayer. But prayer is a two-way process. We have to be listening for God's voice too. And we need to be open to the move of the Holy Spirit. Christ ascended to heaven but did not leave us as orphans. He sent the Holy Spirit to be with us, to lead and to guide. We need to discern where God is at work and joining. We need to be open to God doing the extraordinary. We are to surf his waves rather than trying to create our own ripples. And I have to say, God is doing something quite amazing at this time. He is not the architect of the COVID crisis, but he's using it to take us out of our comfort zone into unfamiliar territory. Deep waters, if you like. And he's saying, let down your nets. 5 weeks ago, we left the building, but we've not closed. We've not gone away. Since then, we've been attracting more people to our acts of worship than we could feasibly fit into the building. We've had to find new ways of engaging with and contacting people through different forms of social media, Facebook, YouTube, WhatsApp, Zoom, but also using telephone calls, emails and texts. Of course, I miss, and I'm sure you miss, the intimacy of meeting together, but we are still active. And it is my hope that we will be open to new ways of doing things and that we will have the courage to move forward into a new normal rather than moving back to the older normal, which I have to say was far from perfect. These are exciting times for God's church. In the words of Isaiah, God is doing a new thing. Isaiah 43:18, forget the former things, do not dwell on the past. See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up, do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland. So in summary, my prayer for each one of you, but also for us together as God's church is this. Let's listen to God. Let's be prepared to go out into the deep waters, out of our comfort zones. Let's be prepared to do the old things, but in a new, different and fresh way. And let's work together as a team, each being part of the net that will allow OBC to be the missional church that God wants us to be. His way. Amen.
Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil why we're made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope like wildfire in our veins. Holy Spirit, come invade us now. We are your church. We need your power in us. We seek your kingdom first. We hunger and we thirst. Refuse to waste our lives. Our joy and prize to see the captive hearts released, the hurt, the sick, the poor at peace. We lay down our lives for heaven's cause. We are your church. We pray, revive this earth. Your kingdom here, let the darkness fear. Show your mighty hand, heal our streets and land. Set your church on fire, win this nation back. Change the atmosphere, mighty hand, heal our streets and land. Set your church on fire, win this nation back. Change the atmosphere, build your kingdom here. We pray.
Well, we come together as brothers and sisters in Christ to share the Lord's Supper together. I think it's very, very important that we're able to do this at this time, because this meal is a connection between all Christians, not just across the world now, but it's a connection between all Christians across the ages. It was inaugurated by Christ himself the night before he was betrayed and was led out to be crucified. And the tradition of this has been handed down from generation to generation to generation. And it is something that connects us all together. So wherever you are, many of you will possibly be in the lounge at home, or maybe in the kitchen or somewhere like that. I just invite you to get the elements of this very simple meal together. It is wine, it could be wine, it could be orange juice, it could be grapefruit, whatever you fancy, and then some bread. And if there's anybody with you, it's great to be able to share together, just to serve each other. But what I really want to impress upon everybody is that we're all diverse, we're all in different places, but this meal draws us together, and especially at times like this, it reminds us that we are one. We are the body of Christ. Together we are one in Christ. And so let's just, with joy in our hearts, not with sadness because we're apart, but with joy because we're together, let's come together and celebrate this wonderful, simple meal. The first thing I want to do is help us to prepare for this. I don't mean the elements, but I mean prepare our hearts for it. And let's just bring before God those things that we are regretful of, those things that don't always glorify God in the way we live, in the way that we act, in what we say. So let's just bring our prayers of confession. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you give us the perfect role model on how to live our lives. And you did that through Jesus Christ when he came to live amongst us. But Lord, we do confess that we trip, we stumble, we fail to be the people that you call us to be. And so Lord, forgive us for the things that we do wrong in thought, word and deed, and in actions, in attitudes. And Lord, just forgive us, we pray, so that we can come to this meal cleansed of those things that do not glorify you. And so I just invite everybody in this moment of silence just to bring those things before God. Just lay them at the feet of Jesus at the cross. Invite Jesus to take them away. Jesus takes those things away to death so that we don't have to. So just bring those things down. Amen. Well, it's wonderful that we can bring those regrets and sins, if you want to call them those things, before God. And he takes them away, because as far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our sins from him. He just takes them away. They are gone. They are forgotten. And that is the word that we get, not just through the Old Testament, but into the New Testament as well. Well, let us come to the table. Let's gather around this table, and let me read from the book of Corinthians. And Paul explains to the church how we are to conduct this simple meal. He says this: on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup. "This is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you remember it, and whenever you drink of it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. And so we eat and we drink, and as Paul reminds us, as we do that, this connects us not just with other Christians, but it connects us with what Christ did for us when he gave his life on the cross, when his blood was spilled, when his body was broken for us. So let us take the bread and eat. And let us take the cup and drink the blood of Christ shed for you. Amen. Of course, we eat this meal, we eat the bread, we drink the wine, remembering that awful event of the cross, but we also do so remembering the wonderful victory of a death that Christ had at the resurrection. And that is what the celebration is, that we celebrate eternal life, eternal hope that is available to us all through the death and through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So let's just pray and give thanks for that. Heavenly Father, we thank you for feeding us with your body and your blood. Lord, we thank you that you gave your life that we may live. We thank you that as we just participate in this simple meal, we proclaim your victory over death. We proclaim your victory over evil. And we know in our hearts that your hope lives in us. Amen. Thank you.
We're going to close with a blessing, but instead of saying it together, we thought we would play a version that's been put together across the internet amidst all the social distancing measures that we're in the midst of.
Shine upon you and be gracious. family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you.
We do pray that you know God's blessing and peace at this time and in the coming week. It's been great to share this time with you. We are in challenging times, but God is calling us to use this opportunity to seek him as to his will for us individually and as a body, his church.
Just a reminder, there is a chance to gather together this evening on Zoom for Sunday night at 6. Also, there are prayer meetings on Zoom on Sunday evenings at 7, including this evening, and Wednesday mornings at 10. It is possible to join with a PC, a tablet, smartphone, or even just making a simple telephone call if you don't have that technology available. We do encourage you to join these meetings, perhaps individually, perhaps as a family, as anyone, regardless of age, can pray and hear from God. This is a time where there's a great opportunity to model the importance of prayer. As it says in Proverbs, train a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not turn from it. God bless you.